In January 2010, urgent work commenced to restore our city's most cherished heritage icon for what is turning out to be restoration of enormous proportions. When it was built in the 1920s, it was referred to as a superstructure, and you're about to see why.
Good evening. Last time we took you inside Brisbane's historic City Hall was to look at some of the challenges faced in the massive job of its restoration. Well, since then, a lot of work's already been done, although from outside it might look as though not a lot's changed. Tonight, we'll show you part of what's already been done and some of the amazing discoveries made along the way as we chronicle the largest restoration of a public building ever undertaken in our nation's history.
Come with me as I take you to the dizzying heights of the auditorium ceiling.
Just being able to reach up and touch the globe in the middle of the dome is an amazing experience. But if you think this is impressive, remember it's a restoration top to bottom.
Down below the basement, archaeologists have uncovered mysterious objects that laid untouched for almost a century. What you're about to see is the delicate work and sheer engineering strength and skill being employed to combat the building's greatest enemies of water from above and below. And along the way, you'll get to see what's been hiding behind literally hundreds of false floors, walls and ceilings added over the past 80 years as a team of heritage experts, archaeologists and engineers uncover structural and safety issues, some of which are far worse than expected. But before we get to that, let's go back to where it all began, right here in the main auditorium, where in January 2010, work began to fix the structural and fire safety issues of the dome ceiling, as well as those notorious acoustic problems. Before any work could begin, there was something that needed to be taken care of. The 118-year-old Henry Willis organ was simply too delicate to withstand the restoration. It's a rare instrument. There are only two of its kind in the world, the second being in Westminster Abbey. So the restoration is a unique opportunity to restore the organ before it's brought back into the building.
They call it the King of Instruments, and my task is not only to get the mechanics right, but get the soul of the instrument or the sound of the instrument right for this building. Normally, if we were going to be working on this organ, we'd leave most of the structure in place and we'd work on the various components. But because the whole hall's being done and because of the dust factor and even the fact we're going to lose the floor here, we're taking the whole lot out. So it is quite a rare occurrence. First time since about 1927 when it was actually put in. We've got basically 2 years to do up the various parts we've got to do up and then put it back in. 2 years sounds a lot of time, but when you actually start analysing every little bit and putting it together on a time frame, we're going to be working pretty hard.
It took almost a month for workers to dismantle all 4,747 pipes and take them away to storage. And it was during this process that they came across an interesting discovery.
These are the show front pipes here, and this looks remarkably like Storybridge paint. And they repainted the pipes in this gunmetal colour with the darker mouths. When the organ first went in, this is the original colour of the pipes. When we actually took the pipe ties that hold these pipes up, there's the original colour still there underneath.
The organ will now start to undergo some restoration work of its own before being brought back into City Hall.
Restoration means that we clean all the pipe work, we get all the action working well, and then We've got to make sure that it's absolutely spot on. We don't want to change the character of it. That's very important, that we maintain the character of the instrument, merely that we freshen it up so that the people who heard it in 1930 would recognise it today.
And it looks as though those large show front pipes will once again be painted gold. Once the organ was removed, the next challenge was accessing the dome ceiling, and this was a construction in itself. Our time-lapse cameras captured the process as workers took 2 weeks to build this magnificent 23-metre-high bird's nest scaffold. Workers now had safe access to parts of City Hall, usually only observed at a distance. It was a rare and wonderful opportunity to appreciate the artistry of the magnificent sculpture work created by the renowned Brisbane sculptor Daphne Mayo. Believe it or not, these are life-sized sculptures modelled by Brisbane residents during the 1920s. Coming up next, we'll show you the work being done around these priceless treasures to strengthen the dome ceiling above them. It's hard to believe that something as beautiful as this could potentially be lethal. But lurking behind the iconic central lantern was one of City Hall's biggest safety concerns.
We're standing above a plaster ceiling, which is made of fibrous plaster on timber battens, so it's quite weak. We have this walkway that we're standing on, which is actually floating above it. And as you can see, it's predominantly made of timber, so it's quite flexible. And it's very, very old. One of the dangers that's present here for people who use this space to alter the lighting for the auditorium is the danger of them falling through this and actually falling through the plaster ceiling and landing onto the floor below.
It was not until the restoration commenced that engineers realised that the shape of the dome ceiling cavity would capture excess water set off from fire sprinklers inside the dome. The timber framework supporting this magnificent lantern is not strong enough to carry the weight of the water. And in the case of a fire, the likely scenario is that the entire ceiling would come crashing down. This is just one of the examples where, unknowingly at the time, new technologies introduced to the building have had a detrimental impact on the building's structure and safety. As work began to erect a brand new ceiling, we went back up inside the dome to see how the new ceiling will simultaneously fix the structural strength, fire safety issues, and those annoying acoustics problems.
Well, this has got to be a one and only view of the dome, hasn't it?
Well, they tell me that no one's been able to see this since 1925, really, but perhaps when a bit of maintenance was done along the way, there were opportunities to see this going on. But you can see this material here, which is called vermiculite. It was put up in 1976 to deal with the acoustic issues. It sort of did help, but what it did, though, in combination with the sprinklers that are above us, then created this fire safety ceiling collapsing problem as well, which we'll now address. We are going to build on what was done years ago. This timber goes, but the steel that's above us will be used to suspend the new acoustic ceiling of the dome. So we'll have modern technology but supported by the original work, and that should deal with the acoustic issues in City Hall.
Just a few short months later, and I got to go up a second time to witness the dramatic changes happening inside the dome, and to get a very unique view of the lantern. A view only ever seen by the few who've serviced the dome over the years. And staring 23 metres down to the ground, a view not for the faint-hearted.
Well, Lord Mayor, last time we were up here in March, we were talking about the removal of the old wooden frames, the old ceiling. It's looking very different now.
Look, it's changed a lot, hasn't it, Andrew? A lot of that sort of garbage, I think, has been removed, really, and it looks very clean and robust now. It's great to see particularly this issue about the runoff of the sprinkler system, the fire sprinkler system. Water now is being dealt with these great new box gutters and the material we're standing on.
Now, these walkways obviously look very different now as well. Why do we need this kind of access up here in the dome?
Well, there's an ongoing need for access up here for maintenance purposes, for the adjustment of lighting. When light, you know, globes, for example, blow, etc., work on the wiring, you always need to get people up in here. So you have to have proper, safe walkways and effective, safe access.
So the engineers tell me this ceiling couldn't be safer. But what about those acoustic problems? Since City Hall opened in 1930, poor acoustics have been a constant source of complaint in the main auditorium. Over the years, various measures were taken to improve the acoustics, but nothing really worked.
Not only was the acoustic not adequate, it wasn't flexible enough. It really wasn't sufficient to give the quality of sound that the room deserved, and it certainly didn't give it the flexibility that it needed to be able to have an organ concert one day and then the Queensland Symphony Orchestra the next day. So they're the sort of parameters that generated the design of the new ceiling and the new acoustic solution in the space.
Thanks to the very latest technology, engineers say they found an acoustic solution that will fix the problem once and for all.
Well, one of the big challenges with the hall is the shape of the hall. Being a big circular hall with a dome roof, circular shapes aren't a great thing acoustically. They tend to focus the sound, so you end up with dead spots and really loud spots in the hall. It wasn't ideal, so we're sort of working against the geometry from the start. You're also trying to develop a solution that respects the heritage of the hall whilst also struggling with the fire and the structural and all the other design constraints. So it was quite a challenging project, but an interesting one.
And what have you been able to do design-wise to change that?
Well, one of the key elements of the design is replacing the dome ceiling with an acoustically transparent ceiling. It's a new product called Barisol, which is a stretched fabric that means we can keep the shape of the dome visually but remove it as an influence on the hall acoustically. It means we can put some of the other treatment behind the ceiling where it's not as obvious. We've also incorporated some variable acoustics, which means that it'll change a bit depending on the mode, but in something like an organ recital, the reverberation times can be a lot longer, so you get a lot richer sound and a lot warmer sound from the organ. And then in things like banquets, it'll be shorter, so you have less interference with speech.
So now that the problems in the dome ceiling have been resolved, it's time to move on to some of the other parts of the building. And if you thought the threat of the auditorium ceiling collapsing was a scary thought, wait till you see the results from some of the other investigations coming up next. It was only once the building was vacated that workers were able to investigate the building structure and compare the original architectural plans with what's actually there. Early investigations helped to plan for the vital work needed to strengthen the structure. But workers soon found that a lot of what was indicated on the floor plans was not in fact what was there.
I thought there was going to be a substantial footing, but it's just a brick footing holding up the wall. It's not what's on the plans. But yeah, it just seems interesting how it's a brick footing and the dirt subsided underneath it, but the whole building hasn't moved.
But not all of the discoveries were from as far back as the original construction. Exploration into some of the building's ceiling cavities uncovered something quite bizarre.
Found some minutes back from 1957. There was an old timber crate up there as well. So it sort of looks like from the findings up there today that...
Bit of ink. Some ink pads.
Imagine if your teacher threw one of them at you. You'd pay attention.
Down below, archaeologists watched carefully as workers used heavy machinery to carefully lift the concrete slab and expose ground not seen since the building's original construction. What they uncovered was of the utmost importance because it provided a link not only to the 1920s construction methods, but importantly confirmed the location and form of the building's much talked about foundations.
What we're finding here is that how it was constructed actually differs from a lot of the construction drawings, and so part of our role is to make sure that we properly understand through the other investigations that are going on with the team while working down here to plan for the conservation work, that we actually follow behind and record the footings, the construction, and all of the evidence that remains here that tells us the true story of how the building was built, so that we can maintain it into the future.
The construction of the foundations was sort of old school in the sense a lot of it was done by hand, by men. What we found is the formwork around the concrete pillars and the holes that the concrete pillars were poured into. And most of the time they then put the concrete in, although we did find some formwork that didn't have the concrete put in place. And unlike today, they actually left the formwork in place after the concrete had been poured. And we're not sure why they did that, and we're also not sure why they left one of these formed up areas. Again, we found some early photos, and even though it's hard to see, we can actually see the formwork sticking out of the ground. So the concrete pillars haven't been poured yet, but the wooden formwork is in the ground and protruding above the ground.
And is there any documentation of what was happening at the time? Is there any indication on plans as to, you know, what they were supposed to be doing?
We do have some records for some guys who actually were digging the holes for the pillars.
Right.
And they talk about how they're digging them by hand, and some of them go down 15, 20 metres.
At the time, it was considered a privilege to work on the construction of City Hall, or as it was more commonly referred to at the time, the superstructure. What archaeologists would find next revealed evidence about the construction of the superstructure, which incorporated a very different approach, using what were new and innovative technologies at the time.
There's a substantial object in there that is possibly truncated, but we'll know more when we investigate tomorrow.
When we first uncovered the structure, we weren't 100% sure what it was, and we knew it was some form of lifting device, or we thought it was a lifting device of some type, and we thought it might have been related to the original work for the foundations of the building, which were quite innovative at the time.
And so we excavated this middle bit, and this is what we came up with. So we got both beams, and almost like it, just before they finished everything, they laid all the proper concrete. They were still using this, and then they came in and just threw rough concrete on it at the last minute. So we got the two beams, and it looks like the base of some lifting device, whether it's a gantry, a windlass, or something. We're not sure yet.
We found a number of photos of the early phases of construction of the superstructure of the building, and I was looking through these photographs, and I started to see images that looked familiar from what we had in the ground, and it became obvious to me at that stage that what we had was actually the base of one of the cranes that were being used to build the superstructure of the City Hall. When they decommissioned the crane, when they'd finished doing the building, they took away all the metal structures but then decided to leave the base in the ground, and they covered it with a concrete slab and left it there. So the archaeology has complemented both the records that we have from newspapers and also early photographs about how the building was being built. Finding this material adds to our understanding of the workers at the time, what they were doing, how they were going about their work, and building techniques and the way the building was being done 80 years ago. And it's because it adds to the ongoing story of a really iconic building for Brisbane.
And it's not just the archaeologists helping to put together the missing pieces of the puzzle. Brisbane residents are coming forward to share important information about the original construction through their family connections to City Hall.
This is your copy of the photograph that was circulated.
Yeah, that's right.
With your dad clearly visible perched on the beam at the back there.
That's right.
What was the story you were told about this photograph?
Well, all that I know about it is that he worked here as a boilermaker in the structural part of the business, and I just know that from those the 24-25 was the year that he worked here, whether it was the start of 1 year, the end of, I don't know, but it was that period.
Alan, your dad is in the photograph as well?
Yes.
What was his job on the construction?
He was the leading hand. They had foreman and they had leading hand. Foreman was the first in charge, and that the workers had to go to the foreman for things, or the leading hand, and that's why he wore a tie.
Coming up, the work on the roof and the work to plug the leaks gradually eating away at the bones of the building. quite correctly, a lot of public attention as to the cause of City Hall's problems has been its location on a swampy site. But over the years, much of the excess moisture from this once swampy site has been removed as neighbouring buildings helped to pump the excess water away. In reality, the main source of water problems in recent times has been up on the roof. This photograph, taken 1 year after City Hall opened, gives you an idea of how the roof was originally. But here's several structures have been added, including, amongst other things, to accommodate an inner city kindergarten that started with just 10 children in the 1940s and grew to over 100 in the late 1990s. Sadly, the roof was leaking like a sieve, and the building structures themselves were frankly dangerous. It all had to go, and what was left behind was a scary sight indeed.
The floor surface has been exposed, and it shows a fairly pitiful example of what has been used in the past to protect the floors below from water ingress. Technology that was used 60, 70 years ago, never been tested in Queensland conditions. The membranes came from Northern Europe and they were used to a cold climate. That type of membrane obviously doesn't have any movement and there's cracks appear. You can see the effect of the harsh Queensland conditions on the roof. It's quite evident that in the past, whenever they did any repairs, they just put a band-aid on it. Obviously at the weakest point, then the water found its way to the next weakest point. But this will be complete stripping back to the concrete and applying a liquid membrane that will be tested to make sure that there is no chance of any leak. And then we cover that again with protection.
The impact that decades of roof leaks has had on the building is almost beyond comprehension. It even took the engineers by surprise. And as we're about to see, without urgent restoration, City Hall was heading on a path to becoming uninhabitable.
There was a problem with the roof. The waterproof membrane on the roof failed. Also, the concrete is quite porous in places, so the water's been able to flow through the concrete in the roof. It's been able to come into contact with the reinforcement, and as the reinforcement's corroded, it's expanded and it's spalled the surface of the concrete.
If you have a look up here, we are on the top floor of City Hall. That area above us is the roof slab, and this is a beam that holds up that roof slab. You can see how the reinforcing is completely devoid of any concrete, and all the cement has actually washed clean away to the extent where if you just touch this material, you can see how weak it is, and it's just all loose and there you go. That's how weak it really is. It's turned into just sand. This beam has effectively become a gutter. It actually, water literally pours straight through it. To the extent where that beam now has structurally failed.
Some of the reinforcement is very badly corroded. Some of it's only surface corrosion, so we can clean that up and repair the concrete. But the most serious areas, we'll have to put new concrete and new reinforcement in. We've taken a huge number of core samples from the concrete throughout the building. We've taken in excess of 200, which have been taken away for strength testing. So they've all been tested for strength. We've also tested chemical composition of the concrete. We've also used ground penetrating radar to actually see what reinforcement is within each of the members. This is a core sample we've taken from the existing concrete frame of City Hall. This isn't necessarily a bad sample. You can't tell whether this is high strength or low strength just looking at it, but that's why we've tested these.
The fact that it's a very rough surface where the drilling is processed, it's plucked out the surface, would indicate that it's possibly a low strength specimen. With its fracture going down, this one's also liable for rejection. But we will test this one and look at it in respect of all the others. The concrete can only stand a certain amount of force, and this is related to its strength. So this machine will compress it until it's such time as it fails. And we'll record the amount of load that it's applied, and therefore we're going to determine its strength. these older concretes, and particularly the weak concrete. The test is over very shortly.
This is the lowest strength concrete I've ever seen in any building. I've worked on heritage buildings in the UK and I've never come across anything quite like this. It falls well below what modern concrete is capable of achieving. Even the code of practice for concrete design doesn't recognise concrete as low as we're finding in City Hall.
It was made in line with best practice for the time and with the materials and equipment they had available. They didn't have the modern pumps or mixers that we have today. So it was really down to the people on site batching, how diligently they mixed the concrete, how well they were able to mix the concrete, what materials they had available.
Now that they've tested the concrete and investigated and mapped out the structure of the building, it's time to make way for the work to repair and strengthen the structure. But the question is, how long will these repairs last?
I can see no reason why City Hall shouldn't last as long as people want it to. Once we've fixed the roof, once we've fixed the basement, we eliminate the two main problems, the two main sources of water into the building. So we should arrest the deterioration in the concrete.
Now that engineers know exactly what they're dealing with, it's time to start planning for the important work to strengthen the building. But before they can do that, they need to get access to the original structure. And this requires bringing in heavy machinery and stripping away layers of surfaces added over the years.
Yeah, didn't think I was going to make it through that last doorway. Oh, very nervous. Yeah, when you started hearing stuff creaking and that, yeah, very nervous. Yeah, but Jono was saying it's all right, so it's cool. If the boss says it's cool, it's cool.
Coming up next, see the enormous transformation underway throughout the building as the original architecture finally starts to see the light of day. In late 2010, the Lord Mayor invited me back to the building to see City Hall as it's never been seen before, stripped bare. Over the years, layers have been added to the building to accommodate changing uses of the rooms. In order to access and strengthen the building structure, these layers all need to come away. It's a chance to remove unnecessary weight from the building, and as you're about to see, there are other benefits too.
Okay, so this is one of the old original window fittings?
Well, original window onto this fantastic light well, and it's been sort of sealed off for I don't know how many years, probably at least 10 or 15, you'd think. Old switchboard sort of sitting here, cables everywhere. Yeah. You know, this is just City Hall, isn't it? It's just, again, just shows you the sort of the way that things have been added onto and how we've lost stuff along the way. I mean, it's going to be great to actually get natural light back into these particular areas.
And as much as possible, do you want to feature these original fittings?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, look, this just, I think it's just such an incredible feature of the building, having these wonderful light wells that were designed so that even in the interior rooms, people were getting that natural light. And when we open this up, and this is then a function space in the future, I mean, it's just going to be terrific, but it's been lost, just lost for so long.
Yeah, so the layers of flooring are being discovered as well.
Yeah, look, this is pretty amazing, isn't it? Sort of, you just see, you know, there's a concrete floor, and then there's this sort of ash sort of material from the new farm powerhouse, then timber, and then other stuff's been laid on top. A real sandwich of layers of history, if you
well,
like.
Well, it looks like lasagna.
Lasagna.
So this original, as much as possible, again, these floorboards may well be used again if they can be.
Well, Andrew, absolutely. I mean, these are part of the heritage of the building. Look, they don't make it like that, them that thick anymore, do they? So yeah, we've got to try and save them.
Now, so this is really opening up, isn't it, now?
Look, it's just going to be fantastic to see this finished, but when we get all this clutter out, when we clean out all this mess of the last 80 years, and then really use it in the way that it was intended. you know, these are fantastic sort of features of the building, which have been cluttered up for many, many decades with all sorts of services, pipes, cables. They're real dog's breakfast. And these things have been like forgotten, almost sort of back rooms, which really destroyed the original purpose and actually didn't allow the building to shine. But there's a whole lot of things that have to happen in here to rebuild the building and to deal with the service issues so that they can fulfil a really important function to provide that light back in. There can be a garden and a bit of space here that people can enjoy, you know, moments of quiet reflection if they break out areas from some of the function rooms and the like.
Heritage architects have been studying City Hall to try to understand its many transformations so that they can plan for how the building will be restored as closely as possible to its original architectural intent.
The building changed roles frequently over the years. So during the war, it had a particular orientation, very much a community facility for women and children, for the servicemen going off to war. After the war, there was a big focus on health delivery and services. So it had a very active immunisation clinic. Then the whole evolution of the kindercraft on the roof, and all of those at some stage needed changes made to the building. And when people are trying to cost effectively modify a building, they don't generally go through and rip everything out that's been in there before. And that generates the layers of either cement or floor finishes or enclosures, and all of those impact on how adaptable the building is now. If we can take away a lot of those extra layers, that leaves us almost with a clean slate to start carefully reconsidering how we modernise this building.
The opportunity that we have in closing the whole City Hall for this restoration work is to get it right. There really hasn't been a chance until this time to actually have an approach that looks at the whole building and looks at the hierarchy of the spaces, looks at the quality of the existing materials, and allows a holistic approach to its restoration and its representation. It is a balancing act between keeping as much as possible of the original building and then adding additional features or additional services that will allow it to continue to be used. Because if you can't do that, then the building will just moulder away and become a museum. It has to live again and has to be looked after. And that will happen if we can increase its functionality, but done in a way that doesn't destroy at all the original fabric and the original design intent and the original qualities of the building.
As heritage architects work on finding increased space for community use, plans were also underway to unite two of Brisbane's greatest icons. A visit to City Hall, followed by high tea at the Shingle Inn, has been a time-honoured Brisbane tradition since the 1930s. Sadly, this tradition came to an end when the original Shingle Inn on Edward Street closed in 2002. But things are set to change. On the 4th of June 2010, a memorandum of understanding between Brisbane City Council and Shingle Inn owners, the Bell Chambers family, transferred ownership of the original Shingle Inn to the people of Brisbane. As I discovered, these heritage icons have much in common. City Hall was the work of architects Hall and Prentice, with T.R. Hall later going on to design the original Shingle Inn. Both were opened in the 1930s and both were prominent meeting places in Brisbane. Proud granddaughter of T.R. Hall, Anne Bullpit shares her pride at having a family connection to both the Shingle Inn and City Hall.
One of his iconic designs was the Shingle Inn, which I'm really pleased to hear is going to be restored as a coffee shop in the City Hall. So many people remember going to the Shingle Inn, I certainly do as a child. Now, it was a very upmarket establishment in its era and had a real Tudor English charm, I suppose you'd call. But yes, I've got many happy memories of that place.
So, what else is in store for the future of City Hall? Coming up next, join me as we take a look at how the Brisbane community is getting involved in this once-in-a-lifetime restoration and future plans for City Hall. 12 months on, and with the building on track to reopen in late 2012, there's still a lot of exciting work yet to happen. In the auditorium, the floorboards are being removed, catalogued, photographed and taken off-site to be refurbished. And before they're returned, workers will dig 5 metres under the auditorium and remove 9,000 cubic metres or 18,000 tonnes of soil as we sort out some of the foundation issues, drainage problems and make better use of underground space. The future, sustainability and preservation are keys to this project. When it reopens, City Hall will have a full commercial kitchen, large enough to cater for up to 1,200 people at any one time. The excavation makes way also for a 150,000-litre rainwater tank as City Hall looks towards a more sustainable future. And all this will happen without disturbing the building's heritage. The architects are not only planning for how to restore the building, but plan upgrades that will see it function well into the 21st century.
The closest thing that I can compare a restoration project on a building is restoring a vintage car, where there are particular parts of that car that need to be authentic, they need to be the original. There are other parts of the car that can be changed to make it work better and to make it more useful, make it more roadworthy, make it more comfortable. And I suppose that is the approach that we're taking what is the inherent value of the building, the inherent qualities of it, and refitting it for a new life. But again, to be the community hub of Brisbane.
For project archaeologists, things are certainly starting to get exciting. Rare and unusual objects found to date are being carefully documented. You can see them on the Brisbane City Council website. National Trust of Queensland President Stephen Sheaf is so passionate about keeping important parts of our City Hall's heritage for future generations.
If there's any building that's of significance, heritage significance, we will fight tooth and nail to preserve it. And the City Hall is such a building. And we are absolutely honoured and delighted to be part of this magnificent project for the people of Brisbane. A city without a soul, without a heart, is a soulless place. And Brisbane and every other city must retain its significant buildings for future generations. It's the heart of the city, it's also the heart of the community. People want to know about their past. People want to appreciate their past. People want to know where they came from, what their ancestors did, and we want to celebrate our past, and the City Hall is exactly a part of that. We want to celebrate the City Hall. It's a magnificent building, and let's hope it stays in its present form for future generations.
Take a trip down memory lane, and it's not hard to see that City Hall is a special place, the heart of experiences for many. And from these experiences, almost every Brisbane resident will have visited City Hall during their lifetime.
We met at a green ball at City Hall in 1999, and we're now married and we have a daughter.
I've been around the world, City Hall's all around the world, and I think that is just fabulous to come home to, and I'm very proud of it and very pleased it's being restored.
For me personally, it is a very, very good project that's happening.
It's an icon like the Story Bridges of Brisbane. And they've got to do everything, I believe, to keep it for the future.
In fact, over 2,000 community groups have used City Hall. More than 100,000 citizens have experienced the grandeur and atmosphere of the main auditorium as they took their oath. And over 1 million schoolchildren have sent echoes through the corridors in eagerness for a school event. Many Brisbane people have taken advantage of the site tours run since the project began. And in early 2011, a room inside City Hall will be converted into a visitor experience centre, so we can all experience the action and excitement of the restoration.
And here we have some more supposed...
On the 8th of April 2010, City Hall's 80th birthday, residents joined with supporters at a party in King George Square. Ian Healy, a strong supporter of the restoration, was there.
Hi, I'm Ian Healy, a member of the Save City Hall fundraising committee, where I get to talk to people and raise their awareness of this restoration and raise funds for the project. This is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to contribute to Brisbane's identity. This building's listed in Australia's top 10, so it's definitely Brisbane's most iconic building. I can't imagine Brisbane without it. I'm basically supporting this project because the architects have convinced me that the schedule of works will preserve this heritage for generations to come. Brisbane, I hope you can join me in this important appeal. My hope is that residents old and new will come together in this historic restoration and help us with the fundraising events to achieve our goal of having the most usable city hall in the world.
A building? No, an integral part of the history and heritage of Brisbane City. And this project and your support will ensure just that for generations to come.